Hello, I'm Lux, and Tyrion,
And I'm Ember, and wow, valid counseling advice from the bad guys.
And this is our thoughts on RWBY.
Volume 6, Chapters 9 and 10.
Excuse my voice, it may be a little rough. So, Tyrion! He went from, like, oh yeah, he's that standard crazy, creepy, bad guy, to, oh my god, he's that crazy, creepy, bad guy.
Yes, because that was a little contradictory. You know, if you don't love what you're doing, you're in the wrong field, which is actually very common job-seeking advice. But he tells them, so we should leave? It's like, oh no. But you notice there is actually poison on the tip of his tail right before he leaves. So he's almost like taunting them, like, please do something so I can take you out for Salem.
Also, it's just, I don't think he's telling them to leave. I think he's telling them to find something they're passionate about that will help Salem.
Because she asked, so we should just leave? Like, no, that's not what I said. And yeah, Emerald and Mercury are not getting along right now. When you want to start throwing punches at the assassin, you know something's wrong.
Also, this is a great way to give backstory, because the character Mercury just dropped a bunch more about his backstory. This is how you give it, in a nice conversation, in a casual way. He basically went, yeah, my father was a real big problem to me. He beat me, he did all this stuff. But it came up in this conversation smoothly because of the context of the conversation. It's not just someone going, tell me your backstory. Well, here's my backstory. That was, we're in the middle of a bar. Great way to bring that in. But now to go over to the good guys for a little bit, because that's, I think, actually where the episode actually started. I do like how Jean is feeling bad about what he did. Because it's not Oscar's fault.
Yes, you're frustrated, but you're taking it out on the wrong person. And yeah, it was all sorts of hurt for you, and your reaction is completely understandable. And on the plus side, everyone was immediately freaked out that they couldn't find him. Because I was seriously thinking that he ran too. Nice fake out, thank you, authors.
I think he was thinking about running, but decided not to, because he said he went off to think. And apparently to shop.
Yes, we're seeing more of the transition here, because he's getting back into Oz's colors. Not that Ozpin had those colors in each incarnation that we have seen in flashbacks, but that was pretty much his color last time, and it does have some similarities with Ozpin's previous costume. Also, just curious, does every one that Ozma ends up merging with have a name that starts with O? Ozma, Ozpin, Oscar.
Yeah, it makes you wonder about some of the other ones. Like you said, were they all O's? Because that would be a good way to track them down. I was like, okay, how many people in this general area start with O? Because I don't think O names are that all that common. And I do like the whole thing with Pyrrha. And I'm trying to figure out, was she a spirit? Was she a sister or someone else?
Spirit, sister, fellow student, just someone from the neighborhood, a teacher at some point in Pyrrha's life.
Right now, I'm leaning towards family. One, because the hair color, eye color, and what's really interesting is the voice. I'm going to have to look it up, but I think it may have been the same voice actress who actually plays Pyrrha.
Yeah, the voice seemed very reminiscent of Pyrrha.
And right now, I'm definitely leaning towards family. I'm very much leaning towards sister because of how young she looked. She didn't really feel like she would be the mother to Pyrrha.
No, but she could be a sister. She could also be an aunt or a cousin.
And the one thing I'm still iffy about, though the roses or flowers were real, so that kind of leans towards that was an actual person. Though she's like a ninja.
Because the second Jean turned his back, she was gone.
And it seems like neither
Ren or Nora saw her.
So, yeah, that's a little interesting tidbit there. And I can finally watch some of those videos that have been suggested to me in my YouTube feed. Jeez! YouTube, Google, stop giving me spoilers!
Seriously. And I stay away from the stuff more than Lux does, and I still get stuff.
I mean, sometimes even those videos end up in my news feed. I'm like, thank you. I am interested in this stuff, just not right now. Can we put like a delay on this? I know it's been a week, but really, because I'm trying like heck to avoid a lot of Steven Universe stuff, because apparently a lot of stuff happened that we haven't had a chance to catch up on.
Well, in the last section that we left off on, things were kind of calm, but it's just building up, so.
Yeah, going off of spoilers onto the episodes we actually watched, which were both really good, and I like how things are leading right into each other from one episode to the next. And I like how Crow's apparently slowly recovering, but he's still unsure about it based on his reactions in both episodes, and the fact that he made it back to the apartment, but he passed out drunk on the stairs. I love the. I wonder what the neighbors think, Elbow.
Well, at least he made it back because we were both predicting, okay, it's time to kibosh Crow over the head and drag him out of a bar and be kidnapped because the intro heavily implies Crow falls.
Either he falls, or he gets really depressed, or he gets kidnapped. Because those certainly look like those shadow hands that Salem uses. So, yeah. Also, I think I finally figured out that scene that's in the intro. It's actually the scene where Cinder fights Neapolitan. Because now that I look at it, I was like, oh, that's actually the bar where the informants were. What's really interesting is a lot of the imagery in this intro is actually from the beginning of this season.
Which we've already touched on several times, is that it's very focused on stuff in the beginning.
But the song is implying stuff in the future, the whole theme of this season. I just find that interesting. Like, this is the first intro that really didn't show anything from later on. Cinder wasn't in either of these episodes. Mention of her and oof. Like we mentioned earlier, Tyrion. Oh boy. Also, I found out some interesting things that like I should have known, like some of the voice actors. I don't know why I didn't recognize Piccolo's voice.
Because it's been how long since we watched Dragon Ball Z? Mostly in the first English dub, back when the entirety of anime that came to the US was Sailor Moon and Dragon Ball Z.
I can also, though I can't understand why I didn't recognize the voice actors who played in Full Metal Alchemist. What's really funny is they're kind of flipped roles because in the Full Metal Alchemist, the voice actor who plays Crow was the short brother. And the voice actor who plays Oscar was the tall brother because he was actually a suit of armor. So when, way back when Crow goes, "Hi, Pipsqueak." It was actually a reference back to Full Metal Alchemist. So I was like, that's cool.
So we're seeing a lot build here because Tyrion's implying that his lady's plan could be in jeopardy. Which, considering that it feels like she has more of the cards than the good guys, because the good guys have to regroup every incarnation, she just gets to keep going. She has time to plan to get new minions.
Though by the looks of it, less time, because she was not expecting Ozpin to be back.
No, not that quickly, but she still has her full staff. What I'm saying is, in this generations-long war, she doesn't have that delay of death and reincarnation. She doesn't have to reestablish herself every time because she cannot be killed.
All Ruby has to do is figure out how to get her to finally realize the importance of life and death.
Which is going to be hard for Ruby because, as we saw in the whole conversation between her and Mrs. Calaveras regarding the Silver Eyes, Ruby's a lot more about the death of the Grimm than the preservation of the life around her.
Though, speaking of RWBY, as Crow said, they grow up so fast.
This RWBY has very little in common with the RWBY from Episode 1, Volume 1. I would like other shows to take note of character growth and character development. It can be done.
Yes, and apparently to most of the audience, RWBY was very stagnant. She didn't really have any growth in the previous seasons, but like, she did, just not the way you wanted her. But this season is like, she is fighting back against the man and going, I am an adult. I can do this.
This is what I want, and I don't really care what you think about it. We've been doing this our way the whole time, and we're not going to stop.
But if you would like to join us because it would be awesome, please. We would love to have you.
But if you're just going to give up, you can go hang because we're doing this anyways.
Though, speaking of Team RWBY, I can't wait for the next episode to see when Yang's going to come in and punch Adam in the face. Because it's going to be the complete opposite of what happened at the end of season 3.
Because I'm pretty sure I heard Bumblebee's engine at the end of that episode.
Because there were also Poe's in such a way that was like, just before it cuts, we're going to see Bumble. No. I heard it, though.
Yeah, definitely heard it. Also, I'm interested, Adam, why the blindfold instead of your normal mask?
Yeah, that's interesting. His outfit's actually a little bit different, too.
I can handle a paring down and a change of the outfit, but the mask is gone and replaced by a blindfold. So was the mask a vision enhancer or a vision destroyer? Because we know from way early on, back when we were able to still have classes at Beacon, that many faunas have superior night vision.
And though this blindfold thing reminds me of a theory that Adam's actually a silver-eyed warrior.
Ah, so he hides his eyes.
Or that he can't actually access the power anymore because he went from wanting to protect life to wanting to get revenge and negative emotions that apparently don't power.
The silver eyes are powered by love. Seriously, every time someone uses it, the divorce rate goes up. Eight-bit theater reference, check.
I never finished that comic.
Neither did I. We got so far past the games I'd actually played in the franchise that it was... Okay, not that this actually followed the story or anything, but it's past the point where I'm even getting the references.
Mm-hmm. The earlier stuff was great. Of course, I mostly fell off on it because, like, I can only read so many comics in the day, and this is college. I need to focus on other stuff. Oh, look at the shiny. But, yeah, we're getting progression in the story in these two episodes. It's really starting to pick up, so let's see where... Yeah. Yeah, we're getting close to the end of the season, because I think it's a 13-episode season, and we're at 10, so that's 3 more episodes.
And things are really intense, because, oh boy, RWBY and Juniper are in so much trouble with Atlas right now. Not really, but with the representatives of Atlas that are right there.
One of them going a bit nuts. I mean, really? You're basically taking Godzilla to kill an ant. What?
Yeah, you could have just scrambled the fighters and forced the plane down or shot it down. But no, you want to get the giant robot. And apparently you're saying all of this stuff over the loudspeaker. So the surrounding citizens are hearing your little rant.
Also, apparently it looks like this giant robot was hidden in that mountain. Because it kind of broke apart and everyone was like, whoa, we didn't know that was there.
Yeah, pretty much, because it's been a pretty peaceful outpost. She's basically been stuck at this backwater station for most of her career, apparently.
Also, I'm pretty sure this giant robot was in case of emergencies.
Your offended pride is not an emergency.
Yeah, this is more like if a whole flock of Grimm come into town, or an actual other military. Also, it just struck me right now. I don't know why it didn't strike me earlier. Her bringing out this giant mech is going to create a lot of negative emotions in the town. So you're doing the exact opposite of what you need to do. I don't know if they're actually going to bring it up in this episode, but this potentially could bring a whole lot of grim to this area.
Entirely possible. Also, I love that Miss Calaveras knows how to pilot an airship. Also, I enjoy that there's a plug-in for her eyes with the ship.
I'm almost thinking it's Atlas technology her eyes are.
Were you watching the past several episodes?
Did she mention it somewhere?
How she has to cross the border every 10 years or so to get the eyes.
Ah, okay, yeah, that didn't stick in my head. I just knew she...
Yeah, it was specifically for maintenance on the eyes, you know, Atlas tech, have to go to Atlas.
Though that brings up the fact that, do you hear this?
This is the sound of me not caring. Like, seriously, you brought a giant bag of cashews with you in the carry-on luggage.
Just in case, just to get revenge. I also like how the other old lady is a kiss-up. Mention this to Ironwood, would you? I also love how Wise was reacting, because she's like, ugh, I hate acting like this. Ugh.
Oh, yeah, this is really what I... Yes, came to my senses. Yes, that's exactly what I did. I came to my senses. Time to get my act together. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm doing, just not the way you think, you stupid woman.
All the characters in this episode are really well done. The way the sister reacts to the whole situation with Jean, and how Jean's like, yeah, we kind of have to do it, specifically us, so we can't really hand this off to another group. And I like how he kind of got, in a way, he got advice from Pyrrha on how to handle the situation and just press forward. Even if you can't complete this goal, what you're doing will still help.
It's kind of like the story of the girl walking along the beach and throwing the starfish back, and the grown-ups telling her, you're never going to make a difference. Throw another starfish back. I made a difference for that one.
Hmm. One grain of rice can tip the scales. I'm vaguely referencing Mulan. Which was a great movie. Though I hear the story's nothing like what we saw. Which makes total sense because Disney did it. I mean, look at the story of the Snow Queen. Hello, Frozen. Completely different. Snow Queen's evil. She is not.
And the Snow Queen is in the habit of kidnapping young men.
So, yeah. I like how Jean brought up the plan, too. It's like, I have this idea, but it's kind of like, if we do it, there's no going back. And I really like how Crow's acting. It's not good for him, but it's good for him as a character.
Yes, it's very good for him as a character. It's not good for him as a person.
Though he does seem to be getting better because of RWBY's pep talk. Though, seriously, at that particular moment where he's like, ranting about how it's all his bad luck, I was like, someone punch him.
Preferably RWBY.
Like, for the love of God, deck him. He needs it.
Seriously.
You're wallowing in self-doubt, my friend. I know your view of the world has just been shattered, but you have friends here. One of them's gonna hit you if you don't shut up.
And you're gonna be too drunk to dodge. Because, drunken master or not, her reflexes are faster than yours.
He's always drunk! Puts down the flask.
I seem to recall him giving them a look and then taking a drink from the flask anyways.
Yeah, basically, like, he lowers the flask and then shrugs and downs it. Also, apparently, there were some people who could take others' semblance because of another drop of information about Mercury's dad.
Well, we knew from the flashbacks of when Mercury, Cinder, and Emerald all got together that he had just killed his father and also just gotten the crud beaten out of him. But that is a thing. We've never seen him use a semblance. And now it's confirmed. He doesn't have one.
Which makes his character even more interesting because he has to fight to get over that. And it shows that he has fought and that he has fought and gotten over part of it. But he's still always fighting because of that disadvantage. And it makes his character a little bit more interesting. Now I see why people say that the most of the villains in this show is the reason they watch it, because they're interesting.
Because they're not just evil for the sake of evil. They all have their own goals and motivations, which make them interesting. Also, they're not constrained by the rules of good behavior. Not that our heroes are exactly adhering to the letter of the law at the moment.
Yeah, I think they're going more along the... trying to remember the alignments here in D&D, because I don't think this is quite neutral good. Maybe it's neutral good.
Chaotic. Chaotic good.
Chaotic good is more what's ever good for yourself. So it may be more neutral good. I would have to look it up again. It's been forever. I know you want to go with chaotic because of how crazy it is, but that's not what chaotic actually means in D&D. I found that out myself. It just means you are out for yourself. So if you're chaotic evil, whatever is good for you, evil way. If you're chaotic good, whatever is good for you in a good way. Like, as long as it doesn't hurt people, I'm okay with it. At least that's my general understanding of my memory. It has been wrong before.
Frequently, but I never actually played. I barely started one time to create one character because somebody was on my case to, if I wanted to read so badly, couldn't I at least read this? Because I was busy reading.
Oi, that was very rude of them. I mean, that's a harsh way to introduce you to D&D. It's a fun game.
Yeah, I know that it can be very fun. My only thing is, I can be trusted to harm my own characters. I promise I can be trusted to inflict damage on my characters for the sake of the story.
So, what? Anything else you want to go over? Because I'll probably remember stuff as you start talking.
Well, we haven't touched at all on... I think their child is very advanced for his age.
Yes. And I think he... actually showed a bit of his semblance.
Because the way that crying went, that was not ordinary crying.
Yeah, no. Also, Tweedledee and Tweedledum are back.
That was amazing. A crying child! We must address this immediately! Wow.
Apparently they're good at heart. They're just apparently not the sharpest bricks in the shed. For the first episode with them, they were just plain annoying. This I'm okay with.
Well, it was a much smaller dose of them, and they weren't just standing there reiterating how awesome their leader is. Oh my god, a little more aggrandizement? Somebody's insecure.
Just a little. Okay, she is just a... I gotta just step into those sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Not the brightest crown in the box today, are we?
Nope. Also the... art overall this season is, like, it's even better than last season. They're really getting a handle on Maya. Though from what I understand, Genlock helped a lot with the way RWBY looks now in this season. There was a lot of cross-pollination between the animation teams.
Which is making me hopeful for Genlock, because overall I'm kind of over mech-style shows, thanks to a saturation in the US about 20 years ago.
Yeah, I'm still kind of partial to Gundam Wing. Apparently that's an offense.
Quite. The Pretty Boy offshoot series is considered the lesser Gundam incarnation, though it happened to be the first Gundam I watched.
Same here. And then the next one I watched was actually the original series, which they started airing in the US. And I believe after that, it was the giant robots fighting each other with motion capture suits. G Gundam, I think it was called.
Mm-hmm.
Shining Finger!
Yeah. Yeah. Still, that was better than the entirely computer-animated...
Chibi Gundam? Or Super Deformed Gundam?
Yeah, that one. Also, how Ms. Calaveras had the jargon down, but didn't bother to disguise her voice. And I'm like, you guys are forgetting to take your finger off the... button. Is that the animators or the story? Nope, that's the story. Like, oh no, the jargon was great. It's just we know our pilot's not an old woman. Oh, you know what? He's got us there.
Also, apparently that communication system is full duplex. Because usually when you have a system where you have to hold down a button, it's single plex, or I don't know how you exactly say it, but basically if you hold down the button, the other person can't talk to you where the button's down. They can only hear you. So you have to let go of the button to hear the response.
But apparently that's only a signal for that to transmit. It doesn't affect the receiver.
So yeah, full duplex means communication can go both ways at the same time. Old Jug and I learned back when people were talking about how microphones worked and how original online voice chat systems actually had to be one way. You could talk and then wait for a response.
Yeah, and don't forget walkie-talkies.
Mm-hmm. I just really enjoyed these two episodes. Wow. I am like so hyped for the next one because there's going to be a lot of fighting between Adam, Blake, and Yang, I suspect.
Just, they cut it off at exactly the right moment. I'm like, it's over already? Dang it!
I remember that happening a lot when I was first started watching the series. It's like, what? It's the end of the episode? It's only... That was 7 minutes, man!
Because, yeah, some of the early episodes were really that short.
What's really interesting about the first season is part of it you can actually edit together, and it's all, like, one episode.
That's actually how Lux had me watch it after I watched the trailers, was an edited version where it just kind of went through sequentially. And it was stitched together very well.
I think it's one of the reasons they released the first couple of seasons actually in theater as a movie.
Yeah, but they're always doing stuff. Right before the new season premieres, you can go in and watch the last few episodes of the old season and then premiere of the new. You know, if you're in one of those shiny areas that gets that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Lucky them.
And I mean, you knew the plan was going to fall apart, but you're like, which piece is it going to be? And the second that Blake didn't start responding on her comm, I'm like, oh, it's going to be Blake. And oh yeah, thanks to a thumbnail that I briefly saw out of the corner of my eye, it's going to be because of Adam. But how the heck did Adam figure out to go there? Why was Adam there? Because he couldn't have known that Blake was going to be there. So why did Adam come to this Atlas Security Center?
Because he mentions it in the episode. He's been following them since a certain time. So he's been off in the distance waiting for her to split off from them so he could get her alone.
Okay, they mentioned the stalker thing, but I was focused somewhere else and I wasn't reading it that way. So he has been in the background the whole time, which explains the shadow in the train car in the intro, because he's been shadowing them the whole time.
It's going to be real interesting. It's like, it's almost to the point that I want to pay for first. Almost.
Not that we don't think Rooster Teeth is not deserving of funds and support. It's just RWBY's the only thing we watch. I've tried a couple other shows. They didn't really hold my attention.
And I'm so far behind on Red vs. Blue that, yeah, it would take me a while to catch up. I stopped watching it because of bandwidth restrictions somewhere in the middle of, like, the second season of that show. way back when they were still using actual gameplay to make a show. So anything else you'd like to go over?
How did Oscar sound to you?
He sounded more collected. And there were some hints, if you're asking about, do I pick up on hints of Ozpin?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So where are you going with this thought inquiry?
Asking because we hadn't talked about it when we were talking about that episode. So like, okay, we're almost to the end here. I'm going to bring this up because he's sounding more collected. And we don't know how Ozma's other merges have gone. Because he was talking to Oscar a lot early on, you know, when he first incarnated into Oscar's body. But we don't know how things progress with the merging. We just know that it happens eventually. Could this be how it goes? That Osmond's just in the background, and in the background there's some merging going on, and it's just a slow, you know, because right now they're more like Yami Yugi, where it's either one or the other, because it's Oscar, and then Oz either asks or forcibly takes over, or how we saw in the whole episode with Jin, Oscar can manage to hold him off.
Hmm. Also, the moment the door opened on the building, I was like, it's Oscar.
And I loved everyone's reaction.
Oh, yeah, the animation in that one particular section was really funny and great. I also love the, we were worried about you. We were this. And then and Nora goes, nice clothes. They're really doing a lot with, like, getting their style of the over-exaggeration of characters' facial expressions for comedy's sake. And they're really, like, nailing it down. Because, like, in the earlier seasons, they were doing things like, specifically in the first episode, there was a lot of, like, weird 2D chibi animation that happened with RWBY at a certain point when she was geeking out over weapons. They still do stuff like that, but not with, like, changing animation styles. They are well within the 3D realm when they do stuff, like when characters over-exaggerate or, like, kind of stretch or... But it's for an effect, specifically in the comedy of the show.
So it falls into that entire tagline of, only when it was funny. But the other part... Wow, his sister and her wife were just totally in on this. Because...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, civilian involvement.
We never had this conversation.
This isn't the first time I've disabled Atlas security. Nothing happened.
Also, I like the fact that Oscar was cooking. That makes total sense for his character. Like, oh no, the souffle!
And the ladies are like, we got it.
So in conclusion, holy smokes, we really want to see the next episode. That's going to be a real interesting fight.
Yeah. I think we have a 7-day free trial laying around here somewhere. And this has been our thoughts on RWBY.
Volume 6, chapters 9 and 10.
Another video, another outro. Okay, yeah, RWBY was totally awesome, right? So before you leave, little housekeeping here. Like, subscribe if you haven't already, ring the bell, leave a comment, watch other videos. We have them in playlists. There's a playlist for every series that we've done. There's a playlist for every category, like video games and thoughts on movies. Yes, sometimes there's some cross-pollination because videos fit into more than one category. So pick what you're interested in and give a playlist to watch. Because there's also the Ember's Reading Room stuff, where I read books and Lux and I analyze and comment because, you know, fair use. No, you don't get to see all the pictures. You want to do that, you have to buy the book. We're analyzing. Fair use. We try to keep our thefts to a minimum. And speaking of theft, not really, because you would be giving to us, right? Lux has a Patreon and a Ko-fi. And those are in the list somewhere underneath all the art and the Tumblr and the affiliate links. They're down there. And you know, he's pretty consistent with the Patreon. You know, monthly polls, monthly sketches, higher quality versions of the art that you may have seen elsewhere. So, yeah. And then, you know, Ko-fi. No commitment. It was, hey, we understand. You know, you're not ready for a relationship right now. We understand. Thank you so much for watching and listening. We appreciate all of the support that we receive in the form of views, likes, comments, dialogue, suggestions, and, of course, financially as well. But all of it is truly appreciated. Thank you to all of our supporters, subscribers, etc., in whatever form you choose to grace us with your presence.